Good afternoon. Today is November 6th, 2007. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's Continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Joan Craig. Our cameraman today is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus, and we are privileged to have with us today Thomas W. Crosby, Jr. Welcome, Tom.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in. May I ask you when and where you were born?
I was born in Boston in April 1942.
And where are you currently living? What town?
In Natick.
Did you grow up in Natick?
Newton in Natick. I didn't move to Natick until I was 10.
What was Natick like growing up?
Oh, it was a small town. I lived on Speen Street, which at that time was a single road. It had the Natick Mall didn't exist. It was a sewer bed for Framingham. And one of the reasons my father chose to live out here, we had friends that lived in the street, and we used to come out fishing. So I liked being here for the fishing and so forth. And my father was convinced that they would never build like they did in Newton, which is why we drove us out of Newton, was because of all the building that was going on. And he was convinced they would never build anything in Natick because it was the sewer bed, and nobody would remove the sewer bed, right? Well, he was obviously wrong, but.
So you've seen a lot of changes in Natick since you grew up here. What's the most electrifying change, do you think?
I don't know. I think probably just the traffic and I'm very parochial. I think of Speen Street. That's really the thing I think about. But certainly the town grew, got bigger. Again, I went to St. Pat's, so I didn't know a lot of people until I went to high school.
Okay. And where did you go to high school?
Natick High.
And what year did you graduate?
I believe 1960.
What is your marital status?
Single.
And were you in Natick when you entered the military? Were
yes.
you living in Natick?
Yes.
Had you graduated from high school at that time?
Yes, in college.
You had already graduated from college.
Yeah, and graduate school, actually. I was in graduate school when I went in.
And where did you go to college?
I went to Dean Junior College, and then I went to Michigan State University. Then I went to Northeastern University, and in a short stint in Portland State College in Portland, Oregon, also.
And what was your final major? Did you say you went for your master's at Northeastern?
Yeah, political philosophy. My undergraduate was political science, international relations, and history. I had a double major. And I actually studied Southeast Asia and China, so my professor was Dr. Fischel, who was the leader of the infamous Michigan State Project in Vietnam. So I met George Ball and Rufus Smith and a lot of people in the Pentagon Papers when I was a student. Okay.
You entered from Natick. Why did you enter?
I had a choice of either going for a PhD or going in the service, and my choice was to go in the service rather than try to go more schooling. I'd had it with school. I was up to my neck in that.
So how old were you when you, did you enlist?
Yeah, well, I was drafted. The sergeant told me I had 4 stars beside my name because they kept trying to draft me. And I enlisted sort of forcibly, I guess is the way to put it. But I wanted to enlist because that gave me a choice of what I wanted to do to some degree.
How old were you at that time?
24.
Could you go to officers' candidate school at that point?
I actually later turned down a direct commission as a lieutenant, first lieutenant. It's a very involved story, but I had been in the Peace Corps. That was that stint in Oregon. And military intelligence officers aren't if you're a military intelligence officer, you're not allowed to be a Peace Corps volunteer or vice versa, okay? At one time, that rule was 3 years, and then they changed the rule. And while I was in the service, getting my captain and I were working on the paperwork, and they changed the rules about the agency I was in had its own officer corps. They were melded into, which didn't have that rule, they were melded into the military intelligence officer corps, which did have that rule. So my choices were stay in the agency I was in, or because of my security clearances, I would be outed basically, and I would go into the regular army, and because of the security clearances, the way the captain described it, would be a very uninteresting job. So I decided to stay in and do something interesting.
So you joined the Army.
Yep.
And in joining the Army, at that time, why did you join the Army?
I joined the Army. I joined ASA particularly.
ASA?
Army Security Agency, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. And I joined to become a Chinese linguist, actually. And I was accepted to that. You had to take a language exam, which I knew I would pass because of the Peace Corps training. I knew I had I wasn't the best linguist, but I had enough skill to pass the test. You had to have double the score that you normally have to get into Army linguistics stuff. And I did barely make that.
When you were enlisting, as you said, sort of forcibly, did other family or friends join the service when you did, or had they already joined?
I had a very close friend, Arthur Wright, who had already been killed, actually, by the time I joined. He was, I think, the first Natick boy killed in Vietnam, I'm not sure. He was killed in 1966 in the Iron Triangle. He actually came home and died in a hospital down in Texas, but... I knew his mother and sister, obviously, and I know that they were very pleased with the care he got. He died of pneumonia. His wounds were not that bad, but he was a tank commander, and he got blown out of the tank. There were other people that joined, but I didn't really know them as well. Chip and I were very good friends.
And Chip was the nickname for Arthur?
Yeah, right.
Where were you sent for your basic training?
Fort Dix.
Fort Dix, New Jersey. What was that like?
Terrible place.
Why?
It was February, March, April, so the weather was terrible, and we were outside all the time, you know, running and doing all that stuff, so you got sick. Basic training's never much fun. It was, that's all I can say about it. Yeah. And I was out of shape because I'd been in college for, 6 years. Even though I played sports in college, I was pretty badly out of shape. I still am, actually.
So during your basic training, at that point, did you receive any advanced or specialized training?
I be a Chinese linguist. After basic training, I went to Fort Devens, in basic training, they told me that there were too many Chinese linguists, so they gave me a choice of several other languages, none of them which were very interesting to me. And in the meantime, they assigned me to be an O5H. O5 training, which is code taking, Morse code intercept operator. I think it's all right to say that now.
And was that when you went to Fort Devens?
Yeah, the Devens had two schools there. There was a beginning school where you had to take Morse code and you had to pass tests. When you did that, then they would move you into advanced training where you would do more advanced training on multiple radios and doing actual work that you would actually do in the field.
How long did that advanced training last?
Well, I left after 9 months probably, maybe 8 months. I volunteered out of it. I wasn't very good at it. I passed the first course, and the second course, I didn't like it very much, and I had trouble. They started using hand-sent code instead of machine code, and it's very hard to explain the difference, but I couldn't get the sounds right, and it's really your fingers reacting to a sound, okay? And I couldn't really do that. And I didn't like it very much anyhow, so I volunteered out, and they were looking for volunteers in administration, and I figured that might be something I could do, so I decided to volunteer for administration.
And where did that take you?
It took me to Arlington Hall Station in Virginia.
Prior to going to Virginia, were you able, because you were stationed at Devens, were you able to come home to Natick often?
Not often, but I was able to come home reasonable number of times. It was difficult to get from Fort Devens to Natick. There wasn't any direct transportation, so I had to go to Boston and then take a bus out. My parents would try to pick me up. My dad would take me back, which was nice. But it's a rather out of the way place if you're trying to get to Natick. Actually, it's a funny story. When they told me I was going to Fort Devens, I didn't know where Fort Devens was because I grew up in what I would call an Eastern Massachusetts kid. My focus was Boston. I'd only been in Worcester once in my life,
Sure.
So when they said, it's in Massachusetts, I said, okay.
Didn't know, no. That's good. Yeah. So going to administration in Virginia.
Yes.
Talk a little bit about that.
I was originally assigned to a personnel office, There were two of us, two enlisted men, and a civilian secretary and a young lieutenant and a major. Actually, that office, I could have got my Chinese language school because the lieutenant ran the school. Okay, so he could assign me to go back and get my Chinese, because they did run, now they had too few Chinese linguists. But I decided I'd had enough school, I didn't really want to do that anymore. And then the manpower study came around, and the office wasn't supposed to have any enlisted personnel. So I was moved to, well, the best thing that ever happened to me in a way, I was moved to the controller's office, as a full colonel. The headquarters, this is the headquarters of Army Security Agency, is Arlington Hall Station, was at that time.
And what station is that again?
It's Arlington Hall Station.
Arlington Hall,
it's a very famous place. If you go into code-breaking books and you start reading, if you heard of Benchley Park, well, this was the American version of Benchley Park. There was CIA, NSA, ASA, DIA, all those kind of places. All those names were there. Okay. And the general, we had a commanding general and a deputy commander who reported directly to the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and they were there, they worked there, and so we worked there, obviously. And he treated the enlisted personnel were treated extremely well, because he didn't control the officers anymore, he only controlled the enlisted. And truthfully, those were the people with the skills anyhow. In this case, you know, they were, we had, my barracks, there were 40 men, the 16 master's degrees, everybody was a college graduate except one person, and he was probably the smartest one of all of us.
How long were you there for?
Ooh, I was there a long time. I was there until I went to Vietnam. And I actually came back there when I got out of Vietnam.
So what year are you talking that you were at Arlington Hall Station?
68 probably, through 69 when I left for Vietnam.
So during your time in Arlington Hall Station, were you given more specialized duties?
When I moved out of the personnel office, I was assigned to the controllers, and actually I was assigned to the Army Audit Agency, who was doing what they called a worldwide vertical audit, which in civilian terms would be a management audit of the agency. Their problem was they didn't have enough cleared personnel. We had all had top secret crypto. You had to have that clearance.
So back up a little. In getting top secret clearance, did you find out later, as some other interviewees that we've had, that individuals from the FBI or other agencies came to
absolutely.
Your neighborhood or to your school?
Yes, absolutely. I actually was in trouble because the FBI had been asking in my neighborhood, and I hadn't been home in 8 years, right? And they finally got down to the Mitchells, which is a friend of ours that we knew for a long time, and the daughter was there with the mother, and the FBI came in, and this was a story I was told, and they said, well, nobody seems to know him. And Marilyn Mitchell, now a Spazy, said, well, that's because he hasn't been here. You know, he's been away, but we know him. You know, so that, I think that had a lot to do with getting clearance, you know, because it's a very tough clearance to get. Top secret crypto is extremely difficult.
Yeah. So in 1969, how did you get word that you were going to be going to Vietnam?
Well, I don't want to leave that apart. I worked on the Army Audit Agency.
Mm-hmm.
This is very important to me. I worked for these civilian gentlemen who were doing this management audit. So I learned a little bit about auditing. I learned a little bit about computers. It was the first time I was exposed to computers. And that was turned out to be very important career-wise. And I got a lot of information about, you know, how things ran in the government. And the audit agency was really an interesting experience. But after they left, they finished their audit, I was assigned to a colonel, a lieutenant colonel, who was a financial, he's the guy that decided if you lost a pair of binoculars or an airplane or whatever you lost, he was the guy that decided whether you got to pay for it or not out of your salary, okay? Very important person, very nice man. I worked for him, and I sat in a master sergeant slot, and I had 38 or so accountants working for me in another location. But I didn't really do much for them. They knew what they were doing. I didn't have to. But I was working for him when I got a phone call. And we had two sets of phones. We had secure phones, and we had regular phones, I guess.
Public phones.
And on the secure line, I got a call from a friend of mine who was a bartender with me in the officers club, who said, your orders just came in. You're going to go to Vietnam. I told my colonel. My colonel called personnel and told them they couldn't have me. He didn't tell them that, but they knew what I assumed. When he hung up the phone, they didn't know the orders had come in yet, because the phone, you know, we were ahead of them in that case. Colonel froze me for 120 days and told them they couldn't have me until they replaced me with a master sergeant E8 with accounting degree or an accounting background. And of course, there weren't any of those. So then he sat down with me and said, "Where do you want to go? You know, you don't have to go to Vietnam. You know, we can arrange other locations for you." You know, I had to go to a short tour. That was the only criteria.
What do you mean by a short tour?
A short tour is what they called a hardship tour at the time. It was a year, but it wasn't a very nice place. Korea, Shimi, Alaska, Azmir, Ethiopia were my choices in Vietnam. And I eventually ended up deciding to go to Vietnam. As I said, my background was in Southeast Asia. I had met Madam Nu. I had met other people in college. So I was, you know, I really wanted to go see what it was like, you know. And I, unfortunately, the people I knew were all deposed by the time I got there, so I didn't get to go to the palace or anything.
Go to the what? I'm sorry, the palace.
The headquarters, you know, the mm-hmm. president's office. Mm-hmm. My professor was a personal friend of DM, who was the president until he got deposed. And, you know, I probably could have gotten an introduction, but I would have loved to done that as a historian. I would have loved to do that. But
now, when you met these individuals,
I was a student.
And so you met them here?
I met them in Michigan.
In Michigan.
Yeah.
Okay. So you got your orders. He froze them for about 120 days.
No, he didn't freeze me for 120. Mm-hmm. We worked out the schedule so that I would have less than 5 months left in service when I came out of Vietnam. And that way I could get an early out. Okay. Now, I didn't actually do that, but that was the thinking at the time. And so I froze me for 30 days. I went on leave for 30 days and came home. Then I went to San Francisco and then reported into Travis Air Force Base, went through the, you know, turn your uniforms in, get your jungles, all that stuff, and then go overseas.
And how did you go over? Did you fly over?
Yeah. Unfortunately, at that time, my orders read, "We'll be not diverted," because that was 69. And they were diverting people out of Vietnam into Japan and other such wonderful places. But my orders were specific that I couldn't be diverted without commanding general's okay.
And at that point, what was your ranking?
I was an E4, specialist E4.
And where did you go when you were in Vietnam?
Well, we landed at Ben Hoa, which is north of Saigon. And I stayed overnight in the, at that point we were separated. The plane was loaded, the ASA folks, now we're called the 509th Radio Research Group, okay, we're no longer called ASA. The 509th Radio Research Group and the MACV people were separated out. We went to our barracks, they went to their barracks, and everybody else went over and drew guns and all that other stuff. We didn't do that.
So you had infantry with you as well?
Yeah, it was
as
a plane full of people. It was a mixed group. Replacement, basically.
And did you go to Saigon from there?
Yeah, the next morning a bus picked us up and took us into Davis Station, in my case. ASA people went to Davis Station.
When you say ASAP, you mean Army Security?
Yeah, we didn't wear our insignia overseas. We were called 509th Radio Research.
But you were, in fact,
ASA.
ASA. Okay.
We had a price on our head, captured alive, which wasn't very complimentary compared to other people. But yeah.
Did you feel at the time that this was an adventure or something different?
It was a mixed feeling. When the colonel that was not the lieutenant colonel I worked for, but the Colonel Holgerboom, who was the chief of staff for accounting, he had sat down with me before I left, and he said, "Well, how do you feel about going to Vietnam?" And I said, "Well, I'm not real happy about it, but I'm going to go." You know, I said, and that was about it. It was a mixed feeling. I said I had some interest in going because I had studied. I knew what I would be doing more or less. I didn't know exactly what I'd be doing, but I knew I was ASA. I knew I was relatively protected, you know. So it was interesting.
So what was a typical day like for you?
Well, I went in, first 3 days, they have you shoveling sand into 55-gallon drums. So after you get over that, that's to acclimatize you to the heat. And I stayed in a hotel in Saigon. And it was a nice little hotel with beautiful marble staircases and everything. It was very nice. I had guard duty there one night, and that's the first time I almost shot somebody. A woman wouldn't stop when I told her to stop, so she stopped when my 45 made a noise, and she said that was very disconcerting because I really didn't want to shoot her. But I also lived in that building, and I wasn't going to let somebody take a bomb in there. Then I went to personnel at Davis Station, and I met with a captain who I'd actually known as, he's the lieutenant that had assigned me to Arlington Hall Station in Virginia. He was now a lieutenant in captain in Vietnam. And he went through my folder and he saw I had, as I said, been introduced to computers. And I had taken a couple of courses from IBM on computers. And so he looked through and he said, oh, I have a job for you. Now, do you want to stay here or do you want to go to Da Nang? And I looked around, and unbeknownst to me, the beaches in Da Nang, I didn't know about them at the time. I said, well, I'll stay here. So I stayed there, and I was assigned. And then my day was basically 16 hours a day working on system, trying to get the person. What happened was we had a computerized personnel system that wasn't being used, so the information was quite bad, I guess is the way to put it. It was not accurate. And the commanding general said, use it. So when I started, that was just me. And I was very fortunate to have the guy I was replacing who had written a little booklet that sort of explained how to do some things. Not everything, but how to do some things. So I took that booklet, and he took me through this. And then I learned how to manipulate the system. And when the general came down and said what he said, I became a pretty important person because now I had the control of the computer system, although it was paper tape transfers and stuff. It wasn't really a computer in the sense you think about keyboards and stuff now. Mm-hmm. And I don't think if kids are watching this, we hadn't even gotten to punch cards yet. We were on autodin tapes, paper tapes that you fed into the computer. So then I went on I was very fortunate to have some sergeants. First, I had some not so smart sergeants. Then I got a really smart sergeant, and a couple of warrant officers, two different warrant officers, who I gave them some suggestions to fix some stuff. They gave me what I needed to do, so I ended up fixing. As an overall record, we were credited with finding 7 programming problems. And we fixed things like the people were, one of the things you did when you were in Vietnam is you chose your next assignment. And the way the system worked is you would come in 30 days or 90 days before you were going to go to your next assignment, and you would choose where you wanted to go. And then we would transmit it on the computer, and you'd get assigned. Well, that didn't work very well because there were a lot of errors in the transmissions and so forth. So I suggested that we do it when they came in. Especially ASA, because those people know we only had a certain number of posts. So they knew where they wanted to go next. So I said, let's just change the order. And so when you come in, you pick your assignment, and then we tell you that you have up until 90 days prior to your leaving that you can change the assignment. After that, that made it a lot easier, and the congressional office didn't call us anymore, and so my commanders were very happy and so forth. And also, what you have to understand is the people that we were controlling were extremely important people. They were highly skilled, as I said, radio. They also had traffic analysts. They had all these people, linguists. I was actually woken up one night at 3 o'clock in the morning to find 3 Cambodian linguists with a specific MOS.
And tell us what MOS.
Job description, job mm-hmm. title. specific job description. Spoke Cambodian, had to be flight qualified, and they had to have more than 6 months left in the service. And the sergeant woke me up and said, can you get me these people? I need them right away. And I said, no way. We're not going to find Cambodian linguists. I went to the office, and of course it wasn't, it was really folders, you know. But I looked up the codes for language that I needed, and I found three people that fit the description in about 20 minutes. It just floored me. I had no idea.
And these were American servicemen?
Yes.
Who and, had?
3 weeks after they did that, we went into Cambodia in 1969-70, the Cambodian incursion, if you will call it the expression. So I said, that's what that was about. You know, you never asked question like that because they wouldn't tell you anyhow, so you knew enough not to ask.
Now, while in Saigon, were you in a safe haven?
I was on Tonsonet Air Force Base, so it was safe. As you saw from those pictures, there's a couple of rocket attacks that were right across the street. One rocket attack that actually hit us. We had attacks every other night. One of the nice things about when they went into Cambodia is what used to happen is these rockets are terribly inaccurate. Okay, they're mostly harassing kind of things, but they were big, and if they hit you around you, they would do a lot of damage. But these little Vietnamese men would carry them in from Cambodia, and they'd walk in half a day or a day, they'd set up these little stands, they'd shoot them off, and they'd walk back and get another set. And so we'd have radar pick up the incoming missiles, the rockets. They really weren't missiles, they were totally inaccurate. And you would get woken up, the alarms would go off, you get red alerts and all that stuff, and you'd run outside, and there's a picture there of the bunkers. We used to have to go into the bunkers. And then we could actually see the ones, you could see rockets flying overhead because they were big, long tubes. And you could at night, you could see the tail and you could see them flying over. And those are the ones you didn't worry about because you could see them. And that meant they weren't coming down on you. And but we had that kind of stuff. We had ground assault training. And actually, I had a machine gun group. We had different assignments during the time where we would defend our compound. And also there was a ready force that we were part of occasionally that would go out to help the Air Force if they broke through the wire. But nobody would ever break through the wire. This was what would happen is if Tonsonet came under attack, Benoit, which was 23 miles away, would launch helicopters to come down and protect us. And, you know, it was suicidal to try to get through this. I mean, they had barbed wire, they had claymore mines, they had open fields, they had dogs, big German shepherds that ran at night to protect the perimeter, bigger than the Vietnamese. I mean, they weighed 90, 100 pounds. They were big, ugly dogs. They were nasty. We used to burn, we had to burn security stuff, and we would go out near the compound where they kept the dogs, and they would just didn't like us being there. They would be all over, you know, making all sorts of racket. They didn't get out, fortunately.
Mm-hmm. So, hot job. You were one of the first to do some form of computerized data.
Well, the system did exist, mm-hmm. and what happened was it wasn't being used. And it's kind of interesting. It's one of the life, you know, you learn about change. And I actually was assigned to go out with my sergeant to talk to another sergeant who was not using the system. And he just didn't want to use it. And it wasn't that his job was threatened. It was the first time I'd actually observed somebody resisting change for the sake of resisting change. I'd heard about it, but I'd never seen it. It was irrational to object to this system. It would help him, you know, make his job easier, but he just didn't want to do it. We had to replace that sergeant, which was not a good thing for him, you know, but we had to get the system working. The general was adamant about doing that. So, and these, as I said, these people had to be in country 30 days prior to the person they were replacing leaving, because it took that long to learn the mission that they were on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty important stuff. It was not, we had missions that ran, tactical missions that ran against ground forces. We also had missions that ran right to the White House. And we also had, ASA is kind of a euphemism for a bunch of different, we had people almost in every organization doing various jobs. The job I was supposed to get when I came out of school before three people, I passed, as I said, I'll go back a little bit, I'm sorry. I passed the first course, and then I was waiting to go to another school, which was a voice intercept school. And unfortunately for me, three people flunked out of the high-speed school, and I had passed that test. So they just took alphabetically the first three people, and that's what happened. I went in, and that's why I didn't like that job. It was another reason I didn't like that job. But I was very fortunate to get in, you know, get my exposure to computers, and I had taken those two courses as part of the audit team. We were auditing the computer system, and I got really interested in that, so that was where I got, that's why I took the courses. And then when I got the things I did in Vietnam to find the errors, they were just high school 101 science. Send a change, see what happens. Do it again, see if it happens again. You know, it was your scientific method. You know, do this. Single thing, keep doing it, and able to document. And I used to put together these little packages and send them off to the headquarters and saying, you know, this program is broken because this is what happens. And I actually sent a general to talk to me. Unfortunately, I wasn't there. I had gone on R&R. But we had another case for him, another demonstration of the problem. And while I was there also, we had a programmer in Hawaii, this is what I'm told, I have no proof of this, had changed the program. He wasn't supposed to, but he had. So all our helicopter pilots in all of Asia got reassigned. Well, this, you can imagine, I was called to the colonel's office, and this is the first time I ever met this is the commanding colonel for 509th. And this is the first person I ever met that was a computer science. He had a master's degree in computer science. Never met anybody like that before. And he was convinced I had done this. First of all, I didn't control officers. I only controlled enlisted men. Second of all, the helicopter, we couldn't do that. We couldn't assign. And the program had done it. This was the old days of computers. So the program ran in Hawaii, did its damage. A tape was made, and it was sent to Virginia, to the Pentagon, and it loaded into the Pentagon computer systems, and that's when orders started being spun out. And the only thing that saved me I think the colonel was ready to shoot me. I wasn't sure. We both had sidearms, so it was going to be interesting, but he got a call from one of his friends in Japan who was complaining that all his officers and all his flight officers had just been reassigned. And one of the things you need to understand is ASA had started to, or 509th had started to use aircraft. And this changed everything in terms of intelligence for electronic intelligence over time. Obviously now if you were to talk to somebody in the thing, they wouldn't use Morse code anymore. All that stuff's gone away. Okay. But the changes that we made with what you were doing was trying to figure out who was where, what the enemy's locations were. The order of battle is called, okay, so you had to know what battalions were where, and these code guys were unbelievable. You could change the operators, you could change the radios, and they could pick out whose hand was sending the code. So they could identify divisions, companies, by the hand that was sending the code. They would change the transmitters, they would change all this other, but they never changed the operators. So they could identify, and of course they knew we were listening because you'd get, at Christmas time, you'd get Merry Christmas GI and things like that, you know, small stuff.
So you were almost under the gun, so to speak, with your commanding officer, yes. But how did you all realize that it was coming from Hawaii?
Well, when the call came from Japan, I controlled Vietnam, I did not control, when I started, it was just me. About this time, I had like 35 people working for me, and I had all of Vietnam personnel for the computer systems under me, and we were controlling all the enlisted assignments. That was the first time that happened. It was really nice. The sergeants and the officers. I never met the officers. I mean, I don't know who decided this, except for the colonel. But they decided we should do this, and we did it. And it was pretty effective, actually.
Now you were. Or were you considered an older GI?
Oh, yeah.
So a lot of these individuals working under you were probably a lot younger?
Some
you?
Were. I mean, ASA is kind of funny. As I said, there were a lot of college graduates in the in the enlisted ranks. All of them, ASA, every individual in ASA is qualified to be an officer by scores. Okay, so it was various choices, like my Peace Corps thing, and other people just didn't want the responsibility, or I don't know. I never really asked them why. Okay, but there, I mean, we're engineers. There were, you know, when I was at Arlington Hall, there were engineers working on computer systems that got out of the service, and the next day they came back doing the same job. They just got a lot more money for doing it. Okay.
You had mentioned earlier also that you were able to go on R&R. How long were you gone for, and where did you go?
7 days, and I went to Japan.
What was that experience like for
you?
That
was great, except I wasn't used to hot water, and the Japanese have very hot water, so when you got in, the R&R centers were upside down. In other words, they opened at night. You know, so you could buy a suit that it could be fitted at night, and they had tours, and so we went all over Japan. I studied Asian history, and I spent a lot of time in Japanese history. So I went to Shogun's castles. I went to PX shopping, of course. Everybody went PX shopping, and we had good food. And what they did was they charged you 50 cents a night, and you got a bed, and you got hot water, and I do read hot. And that was the biggest shock, I think. But it was very pleasant, and it was nice to be in a place where we went to these Shogun's castles, for example, and it was summertime, and all the little kids would be there touring, and they all wore uniforms for their grade. So there'd be 500 of these, you know, say 60 kids, and they'd be in yellow shorts with straps and hats and beanies. And in Vietnam, the kids would be begging all the time, and these kids would just work as a group, and all of a sudden you'd get, "Hello, GI." All 50 of them at once, you know, they just, because they obviously knew you were who you were. I mean, you know, it was very hard to, in that country, not to be noticed.
While you were in Saigon, and were you able to get news of what was happening elsewhere?
Sure.
How did you hear that?
Television, primarily.
You had television set up where you were?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We had radio also, but we had a... one of the guys had a 21-inch television in the cube, and I had a small television. And for example, I watched the Boston Bruins win the Stanley Cup. I watched it 3 times in one day because it was on three. They played it 3 different times, so I got to watch it all 3 times. Those kind of things. We watched. That's why I said one of the things I was concerned about was I saw the news that was being shown in the States, so I made these albums and sent them home so that they wouldn't be so worried as they were obviously going to be, you know.
Because they were seeing certain
They were seeing the war on television, just like we did, but that wasn't what was going on. There were, you know, 500,000 soldiers in Vietnam. A very small percentage of that was actually doing the fighting. You know, now people like us, we were supporting them, and we were doing all the intelligence to try to keep them out of trouble and to, you know, work on where they were, where the enemy was, and so forth and so on. But we weren't direct combat, although we did have rifles, as everybody else does.
Sure. Know. Were you there for a full year?
Yes.
Did it go by quickly for you?
Yeah, it seems to have gone by pretty quickly. In fact, I didn't realize. As I said earlier, they were sending a general, and they wanted me to have another case to show him, and I had one. I had been working on one, but I hadn't really refined it yet, and I was supposed to be on R&R, and they couldn't not let me go because I'd been there 11 months, and I had to have my R&R before I went home. So they said, well, "You got to go. You can't not go." So give the case to. They had flown in from Germany a guy that was going to replace me. So I showed him the case, and I got to go to Japan, and he got to do the general. You know. I knew the general; he was a very nice man, because he was at Arlington Hall, so I knew him from there.
And once you got back, you had short time, as you had mentioned earlier.
No, that didn't work. I requested a month extension so I could stay in Vietnam the month, and I would have my 5 month early out, and they didn't let me do that. I requested it 3 times. They turned me down 3 times. Turns out they wanted me back in Arlington Hall Station to discuss some of the computer issues and do some training of people out. We had another location in Virginia called Vinhill Farms, and I went out there and did some training on the system and so forth.
So you came back from Vietnam and went to Virginia.
Yep. back to Arlington Hall. And that was a good thing for me because in that time frame, it was very hard to get a job. People, you know, it was a recession in the civilian economy, a lot of servicemen getting out. Jobs were very hard to come by. So I figured that was a good thing. I stopped fighting it. I figured I'd go back and it would give me 6 months to find a job.
And you were in Arlington Hall then?
Yes.
For 6 months?
Yeah, 5 months.
Five to 6 months.
Yeah. I came home for 30 days. I didn't stay the 30 days. I stayed like 15 and then went back because it was very dicey with folks here. I went to parties and people didn't want to talk in front of me, and I didn't, you know, I felt very out of place. So I wanted to go back where soldiers were and I could talk, you know, we didn't talk about the things that people in civilian life were talking about. And that didn't make people uncomfortable. That was my biggest issue. I went to a wedding that I had to go to and talk to my friends. And then in 15 days, I was ready to get out because there was not much to do.
When you came home like that, was it at a period of time when there was dissension across the country?
Oh, yeah.
Was that happening during that time?
That was happening all the time I was in the service. I was actually, well, Martin Luther King was killed when I was in Washington, D.C., and I had the disconcerting experience of riding in a with the beautiful cherry blossoms. It was April. Early April, so the cherry blossoms were out, and they were just starting to get riding in with a machine gun and a loaded machine gun, a 50 caliber machine gun, and a jeep riding down the Capitol. You know, we only did that one night, and then the day, and then real soldiers came in, and as we called them, real soldiers came in and took over the jobs. But we had that for a day.
So seeing something like that, though, going down Main Street by the Capitol of the United States, was
and
that
it was also Washington 14th Street was basically burned to the ground. You know?
And was that even more disconcerting for you than being in Saigon?
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was a very disconcerting experience. Plus, we were there were supposedly illicit radios, and we had people working that. So it wasn't clear what was going on.
When you mentioned illicit radios and people working, what exactly did
by
that?
We had illegal radios being transmitting messages and so forth, and so we had people intercepting those messages as our job, you know, trying to figure out who was doing what to whom, and was there a conspiracy, or was it just a bunch of people very upset? I think the latter is the case, rightfully so, actually.
So when and where were you discharged?
I was discharged in February 71, I believe, in Virginia, in Arlington Hall. Actually, what they do for us is they transfer us out of ASA and into the regular Army, then they discharge us. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And at what rank at that point?
E5.
And E5 is a sergeant. Like a sergeant?
Yeah, three-stripe sergeant. But only can only give orders in your job. You can't give orders to other people unless they work for you.
So having already been home on a visit and having a little discomfort, what were your feelings about coming home permanently?
Well, I tried very hard to get a job in Virginia. I worked for a civilian in the office I was assigned when I came back. He tried to hire me, but they weren't hiring trainees, which I was as a programmer. I would have been a trainee. I didn't know much about programming. So I couldn't afford to keep my apartment. I lived with four other soldiers off post at that time, so I decided to come home, and I had some money saved, so I figured I'd come home, find a job. My mother was a personnel director. She would help me find a job. Of course, it didn't work out that way, and actually my first job was in the town of Natick under the Emergency Employment Act, working for the town secretary in computers. They didn't have a computer. They had a high school computer where they ran some stuff, but they didn't have payroll or any water sewer billing or any of that stuff. So I went down to Wellesley, and they also had a computer, and it was somewhat compatible, and they were willing to give us the free programs and so forth, but the town didn't want to do that without studies, and so they spent money to have studies done. I felt a little bit, I thought that was a waste of some money, because deciding whether you can do a payroll or not on a computer is kind of stupid. I mean, I'm sorry, but as you know, as obviously everybody did payroll on computers by then. But they decided they needed to study, and they hired a group. They came in, they studied it, and they said, "Yeah, you can do it." You know, they didn't want to do it on the high school computers, which I thought was fine. You know. But in the meantime, I went to classes and so forth, and found a job in Saugus.
When you say you went to classes, was this more computer classes?
Yeah, well, it was GSA. You know, because I was a Vietnam veteran and I was in this program, Emergency Employment Act program, I could go to the government training. So I took the middle management training, the government middle management training, as much as I could get, not computer specific, but management training generally. You know, they would videotape you. And you had to not move too much and all that kind of stuff.
They would critique that?
Yes, all that kind of stuff. So I took all that. And then my mother had a person that she had worked for who was looking for a programmer. And so she was going to try to hire him one. And she just happened to mention to him, "But I wish you'd consider my son next time you're looking for somebody." And he said, "Well, I'll consider him now." So I went to the Wellesley Country Club and had an interview at the Wellesley Country Club, which I always loved because, as I said, I had been a bartender, and they have this gorgeous copper-pounded bar, and I was just in love with that bar. I thought that was gorgeous. So I went there, had the interview, and got the job, and that was important to me because it got me out of government and into the civilian world where I did accounting programming. Basically, I wrote assembly language programs for backroom operations for mutual fund is what I ended up doing, and that was my first programming job.
And how long did you stay with the Wellesley Country Club?
Oh, it wasn't the country club. It was just the interview.
Oh, that's where you stayed. Yeah. I'm sorry. That's where you interviewed.
Yeah. So I stayed there about a year and a half.
And what company was it at that time?
It was called Shareholder Accounting Corporation, and basically it was two owners and me. But the owner was a fairly well-known person in the mutual fund business, which was obviously based in Boston at that time, primarily. And he had connections, so we got jobs putting in these computer systems and doing this accounting. But then the banks, it got tough for the banks, so they lowered their prices and it made it cheaper for them to go to the banks. So that's how I found Data General, because I was looking for DEC and Data General. We were looking for cheaper computers, smaller computers that we could do something on. And I ran into Data General and Digital, interviewed at both, and got a really interesting job at Data General, which is why I took it. And that was my really breakthrough into becoming a professional computer person.
And how long were you with Data General?
Well, I'm still with them. Basically, EMC bought Data General, so 35 years.
So you're currently with EMC.
Yeah.
Did you, once you came home, join any unit of the military reserve, veterans organizations, or
American
Legion?
I joined the VFW and Legion because they came and said, you know, Vietnam veterans at that time were not. I went to the VA once too, just once, and it was. Vietnam veterans weren't even popular with the VA. You know, they were all mostly Second World War vets and didn't think very much of us. I didn't think very much of the Korean War veterans either, evidently. I only knew a few of those. And it was kind of sad. It's much nicer to see how soldiers are treated now, although I still have some gripes about that. But civilians treat soldiers better than they did then. I mean, there were cases where I remember coming home and to visit, and I had flown into Boston, and I'd taken the train, the subway from the airport, which is the Red Line, to Congress Street, which is where my mother worked, and got a lot of dirty looks because I had to be in uniform to fly. You know. My mother actually got in a fight with some woman on the bus because she said something disparaging about a Vietnam veteran. You know, yeah, it was not a very good time to be coming home. Yeah. And on top of that, with the everybody out of work and everything, it didn't help either, you know.
True.
But we were all considered baby killers and all this kind of stuff, which had, you know, no real. In fact, my unit had an orphanage that we supported, and we gave them food. I had aunts that were nuns. I had them send over toys. We got toys from other places, you know. And the Vietnamese people are really nice people. I liked them a great deal. very industrious, very hardworking people. And it wasn't really, we tried our best to be good soldiers in that sense. You know? And I'm sure that's what's going on in Iraq now too. It's just that you don't get to see it because it's not news.
Absolutely. Yeah. Did you or do you attend any reunions of your old group?
No, it's kind of funny. Because of the way Vietnam worked, where you came in and you rotated out, there's not much way to keep in touch with people. You know, you rotate in, you rotate out, and you just say goodbye. You know, we had parties when people left. That was one of the biggest celebrations. We had one probably every week. You know, somebody was leaving, and we just said, hallelujah, get the hell out of here. You know, and that was the end of it.
How important do you feel it was serving in the military?
Well, I think it was pretty important. At that time, especially because it was a draft. So if you didn't go, somebody took your place. And I had a girlfriend at the time who really wanted me to go to Canada. And I just said, I can't do that. Plus, my friend Chip had been killed.
So you felt that was
so
important.
I didn't think that was appropriate.
Do you feel that in some ways it affected your life, the training and the background in the service that you received?
Oh, I think it did a lot for me because it got me into computers. It certainly gave me, it also socially gave me some problems because I didn't want to socialize with people because of that piece. Eventually got over that, you know, but first few years it was difficult. And I don't think I had, stress syndrome or anything like that. I think I was just, you know, one of those guys that came back and took it somewhat personally that people, you know, thought I was that scarred that I couldn't have a conversation and understand somebody having a different opinion about the war. Certainly we all had opinions that had nothing to do with why we were there. You know, when you're there, it doesn't matter what your opinion is. You're there, you have to, that's the thing that people, I guess a lot of people will tell you, is in the service, you depend on people to do things. It's their job to do it. And if they don't do it, somebody gets killed. So you learn that that's important, and you do it. And so you learn teamwork, you learn responsibility. I saw 18-year-old kids, I was pretty old. I saw 18-year-old kids that were given responsibility. I couldn't understand. I guess that's the thing I should say. I really couldn't understand when I was in the States why these guys would come back from Vietnam and volunteer to go back. And I said, what are you, crazy? And then when I got there, I understood, because in the States you were not given the responsibilities. In Vietnam you had tremendous responsibilities. No matter what your age, no matter what your rank, mm-hmm. You know, you had a job to do, and usually they were pretty important jobs. Mm-hmm. Whether it was an infantryman, you know, protecting the guy next to you, or doing what we did, or whatever, it was pretty important work.
Sure.
And it wasn't really, you didn't have an attitude about the war. You know, I would say if you asked any soldier ever, they would say they didn't like war. I don't know anybody that does. And if they do say that, they've never been in one, I don't think. But the reliability of the people, I mean, it's very important to me. I have people that work for me now for 15 years. And one of the reasons they continue to work for me is they do their jobs. And I've always had that as a criteria. You know, you can't have people you don't rely on. And I'm still that way. You know, people, my friends, are all people I can rely on.
Sure. Looking back, is there ever any one moment, memorable moment, or character, or even a humorous experience, one, or it doesn't even have to be humorous, but something that really kind of sticks to you?
Well, I could give you a couple. I'll give you, we had a guy named Staker, who really hated the Army, hated being in Vietnam, and used to get drunk a lot. And we had the NCO club was right across the street from our barracks, a very good NCO club, I might say. And we were entertaining ourselves by trying to kill these big bugs. And we were doing a scientific experiment to see which yard guard or the army spray would kill this bug, and none of them were working. And we had the floor soaked pretty much with this stuff. And he came in, he said, look at that bug, and he just stomped on it, and that just broke us up. Then another time he got drunk, and it was during Tet, so we had weapons in our lockers. And he came in, and he was really mad at the first sergeant. Really very mad at the first sergeant. So he came in, and he wanted his gun. We wouldn't give him a gun. So then he took his tennis racket, and he goes out, and he starts swinging at the first sergeant. And he was really drunk. He couldn't even stand up. And the first sergeant almost got hit because he was laughing so hard. Those kind of things, you know, very human and very understandable in some cases.
Sure.
You know, if you have a bar across the street, you can drink a lot when there's nothing else to do.
When you mentioned Tet, did you have a more secure lockdown, so to speak, when that was all going on?
Yeah, the year I got there was the year after the Tet Offensive. Mm-hmm. So we didn't normally keep our arm. I mean, I had a sidearm, and my Jeep was armed because I drove, and my driver and I would drive to, from Tonsonet, we drove to by the Third Field Hospital, which is in the Cholon section of Saigon, into the Joint Chiefs of Staff compound, the Vietnamese Joint Chiefs of Staff compound. So we were armed, but most of us didn't have arms. They were kept in a locker, you know, in an arms room. At Tet, we all had our guns in our lockers. We didn't have the ammunition. That were kept in a separate locker under the sergeant's control. But each barracks had ammunition. So that if we needed it, we could get it pretty quickly.
Sure.
Rest of the time we didn't, except for people like me who did that kind of stuff, move back and forth. Now, we were qualified with M16s and M14s and machine guns, actually. But I had an M14, and I was very happy about that because I didn't like the M16 very much. So.
What was the difference?
Well, the M16 was a very good weapon if you were carrying it and you had to carry a lot of ammunition. It was very quick pointing and so forth, and it had a higher fire rate. The M14 was, and it was a 5.62 millimeter, which is basically a big 22. And the M14 was fully automatic M14, had a 7.62 round. And because we were surrounded by buildings, tin buildings mostly, I wanted the bigger bullet because I wanted to go through buildings if I had to shoot at something, you know. I wanted it to go through it. And I'm a very good shot. I used to belong to Shaw's gym, you know, rifle club and all that stuff. It was a very good shot. So.
Did you ever have the need to use it over in Vietnam?
No. Except for that one time I talked about, and that was a .45 with the woman.
Sure.
But we got called up a couple of times, but we never had to go do anything, and I'm perfectly happy about that.
Is there anything else you'd like to add as we finish up this interview, comments you'd like to make for people who might be viewing this tape, family, friends, and the public?
No, I think I've said most everything. I think the thing I would leave is, you know, you should be nice or treat soldiers with some respect. I think that's happening this time around. I don't think it happens. I know it didn't happen in the Korean War. I remember my cousin coming back from the Korean War, and he didn't get treated very well. And I know it didn't happen well for me, and I'm sure for other Vietnam veterans. And that's somewhat disconcerting, because you think you're serving your country, you think you're doing your job, and the politics have nothing to do with what you end up with. You know, it's a totally different environment. That's about all I have to say.
Well, Thomas W. Crosby, Jr., we want to thank you for coming in today. This was a great interview.
Thank you.